This project is sponsored by Historic Fairfax City, Inc. Included are memories from a person's associations with a particular historical period, events, and persons within a specific context. We can capture orally what is often not written down in order to capture the memories of longtime residents of Fairfax. An oral history candidate is an articulate representative of a group, an old-timer who can describe a past way of life. We know in terms of oral history, the best historical evidence is given in the words of people closest to the events. Lee, I wanted to begin by asking you to give a thumbnail sketch of the 10 generations of your family that have lived in this area.
John Simpson came to this area down on Hunting Creek and the Potomac River in 1678. Then his son Thomas. Now John was born in Scotland. As far as I know, the rest of the family were born here. This was Stafford County then. Stafford County until 1731 became Prince William County, this area. Then in 1742, this became Fairfax County. So that line of Simpsons stayed here in the county, and there are a multitude of descendants still live here.
And your family live primarily in the Fairfax Station area.
Yes, yes.
And so on. And your father had, as a side project, some farming land as well as his own area.
My father bought some land in 1943, and we farmed that as well as neighboring property that was vacant, so we would farm it too. My dad had come here in 1926 from Louisiana to work on the Ravensworth plantation. And that was in February of 1926. In August of 1926, the mansion burned at Ravensworth. Wow. And he worked at various jobs and even worked here in town at the old sanitary store on Main Street. And then later got a job at the workhouse down near Lorton, and that's where he retired. He made that his career. But he always farmed.
Everyone knows that you have a keen and thorough interest in all Fairfax history, and that you've also have developed an archive, wonderful archive of photographs. Would you tell a little bit about how you got interested in pursuing your sort of a local kind of semi-historian?
We lived next door to my grandparents, my mother's parents, and I was constantly asking them, because my grandfather also came from a family that had a place on Braddock Road up towards Centerville, a big farm. And they have been here for generation after generation. So I was constantly questioning them about how we were kin to this person or that person, and who lived here, and that type of question. And by doing that, I learned a lot about the neighboring families and our connection, and so many of the families at Fairfax Station were kin in some fashion. And then I started collecting old photographs. My grandmother gave me a lot that she had, and it just got to be just a fun thing to do.
Your whole collection, you, I guess, have scanned into your computer now, so you have a fairly systematic record of any photograph.
I still haven't finished. I've got hundreds on the computer, but I've still got more to scan and save.
I wonder if you would talk some about some of the family stories you remember hearing from family members about historic events.
Well, World War II, I was five, almost six, when we got the U.S. got involved in it. And my older brother and I would we'd go around with a wagon and gather up scrap metal.
How about rationing? your family was affected probably by rationing. Right. What was the hardest thing to get? And
well, sugar was hard to get. My dad's mother and father lived in Louisiana, which being a cane growing state, they could get sugar. So I remember occasionally my grandmother would send up a quilt she had made, and in it would be rolled up a 5-pound bag of sugar. But I've still got all of our ration books for my sister and brothers and my folks.
Now, some, I remember shoes were rationed,
yes.
Also gasoline.
My father, being a guard at the workhouse, had an A sticker. They gave you a sticker that you put on the windshield or rear window of the automobile. And the letter indicated how often and how much gas you were allowed to buy.
Oh. Yeah. You were describing something that was fascinating about German prisoners of war being temporarily incarcerated here.
There was an old state prison camp, road camp, on Route 29 or Lee Highway, just west of Camp Washington. It was actually where Waples Mill Road now intersects Lee Highway. We called it Old Camp 30 because there had been a newer Camp 30 built up at West Ox Road. So they housed a number of German prisoners of war there. They did in several spots in the country, but this particular group were here at Old Camp 30. The local farmers were allowed to sign them out for a day, okay. A number of them. Mr. Haight, who had a farm, dairy farm, where the Courthouse Country Club is, or the Country Club Fairfax on 123, excuse me, he would get some. And across the road from his place was the Dr. Brooks farm. Now, Dr. Brooks had died in 1941, but his housekeeper, Mrs. Kidwell, inherited the farm and continued to run it. My dad was friends of them, and then Dr. Brooks was our doctor. And he worked up there helping Mrs. Kidwell. And I started working there when I was about 12. But they brought two of those soldiers there, the German soldiers, to work one day. We took those two, or my dad took those two young guys home with us for lunch. And one held up a glass of water and showed me, and he said, Wasser. And then he held up a table knife and said, Messer. And I just recall them as being, you know, relatively young men. And I had heard they liked getting out and to work on these farms because it was better than sitting in the buildings up there, which were not permanent structures. They were wood and canvas and wire.
What were some of the main activities that you recall in growing up, either with yourself and other young people or with your family?
Mm-hmm. You know, all kids played sandlot ball. And then we had a couple organized baseball teams. Dick Boyer started one for kids my age when I was about 14. And then we had one called the Fairfax Red Sox, which was, we had uniforms. And
Anything else?
No, I think that's a thumbnail sketch.
Well, thank you so much. And
thank you.
Because we appreciate also all of the information you give us. You're a fact finder, and you're very accurate. Mm-hmm. Plus, your photographs have made such a wonderful contribution to, I'm sure, not just HFCI, but to many groups that are looking for old photographs.
Well, it's my pleasure.
What year were you born?
June the 27th, 1916.
And you were born in the house?
Uh-huh, I was born in the house.
Were you attended to by a doctor? Or?
They called them midwives.
Midwives?
That's what they called them then.
It sounds like you were daddy's little girl?
Yes, I was always daddy's little girl, and I would always be jealous if someone else sit on his knee before I could get there. And I would sit on his knee. And he taught me how to read the Bible and explained to me about the Bible.
What did your father do?
He worked on the railroad, Arlington and Fairfax.
The trolley line?
Trolley car, right. Yes. My mother would get up every morning and make hot biscuits. And he would walk from here up to the trolley line up in the city of Fairfax and catch that 7 o'clock trolley. And then we had garden up there. We had cows, pigs, chickens. We loved to go down to the chicken house and get the eggs. We never knew what it was to go to the store and buy food. My daddy raised his. We had garden, we had strawberries and cabbage and corn and chickens and eggs and pigs.
So and you didn't shop in stores much?
Not very much.
Did you
only
make
the
most
necessary
of your clothes?
Things that we couldn't raise.
What school did you go to?
Well, the school I attended was a little school down the hill from the undertaker parlor up here in Fairfax.
Really?
Yes. And we had to walk out through those woods and down that hill. And the little schoolhouse didn't have but two windows. We didn't have any water in the school. We made drinking cups out of paper. You take that tablet paper we had and we made those drinking cups. And we go down and dip it in the water out the branch and drink it. And I think that's why I've lived so long. You know, I just love school. I wanted to go on further. Well, there was no high schools in around here then for the colored children. So Mrs. Hughes, she said, well, I'll tell you what you do. You send her on back, and I will teach her as far as she wants to go here. So I went back, and she taught me the 8th, 9th, and 10th grade. And that is far as I went in that school. But then I went to business school. Every chance I got, I was in some school or someplace learning. So after that, I said, well, I'm going to find me a job. And Mrs. Saunders in Falls Church had a little shop, employment place on a corner of Lee Highway there in Falls Church. And one day, Danny Boy and I was coming down the street. We'd been into Washington. She said, I've been looking for you. I said, you've been looking for me? She said, yes. I said, what you got? She said, I think I got just what you want. She said, you take this telephone number, you call this lady. I told her, okay. She didn't tell me who she was. Well, when I found out who it was the principal of a school. And that, I went for that interview at Oak Street School in Falls Church. And she and the head custodian said, oh yes, we want her, we want her. And I started work on Monday and I put in 25 years and retired as a building supervisor. And I was the first lady that was hired in Fairfax County. And the first one that they ever had a retirement party for. The principal, one of the assistant principals got sort of angry with me a little bit.
Why?
Because you know how you take and they would mash their cartons on the floor of milk and milk would just go everywhere. And the principal had told them to stop and stop and they didn't stop. So I took a paper and I went over to that corner where they were smashing those. And I stood there at the door and watched and pretended like I was reading my paper. But I was watching them too. So finally I said to the boys, I said, let me tell you something. You know, I don't feel very well today. I said, and we have to clean up this cafeteria. I said, can't you all help me pick up those milk cartons that you have spilled there? They said, oh, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, we'll help you. That's after they had integrated. And those boys got there and they cleaned up. They said, do you have a broom or mop and we can clean it up? I said, sure, I'll get you a broom and a mop. I went and got them a broom and a mop. And then I stood there and talked with them and talked with them a long time and asked them where they lived and everything. Some were white and some were black. And they cleaned up that place just as nice as you please. And the assistant principal come up and he said, well, what has happened? I said, the boys cleaned it up. He said, they cleaned it up? I said, mm-hmm. He just turned and walked on away. But the principal, he wondered, he often wondered. He said, what did you do? I said, I didn't do anything. I said, you know what? Children don't want to be hollered at. I don't holler at children. You talk nice to them and you can get them to do most anything that you want them to do. I said, but you can't dog a child. He has feelings too. You love everybody. I don't care who they are. They could be black, gray, green, pink, yellow, any color. I love people because God loved us all.
Amen to that. Well, on that note, I think that we will wrap this up, but we thank Etta very much for sharing her stories with us and wish her well. Thank you.
Oh, I'm sure you're welcome.
I am here in the home of Gladys Potterton on McLean Avenue, interviewing Gladys Potterton and her cousin Betty Roby, who both were born here in Fairfax City.
We'll begin at the beginning. You were born where?
In Fairfax, Virginia, right. Cedar Avenue.
On the corner of Cedar?
Cedar and McLean in 1924.
Right. Mm-hmm. For pretty much all your life, you've lived in this row of houses right here.
Yeah, that's right.
Right.
Then I did move to Centerville. Then I came back here.
Right. Mm-hmm. So I imagine that you've seen a lot of changes here on McLean Avenue. Would you like to describe some of those changes, such as, you know, the surrounding properties, the school across the street? What did that start out with? Was that just a field?
It was a fairground.
This is the location of the old Fairfax High School, which is now Paul the Sixth.
Paul the Sixth was the fairgrounds.
Mm-hmm. So did you graduate from that school?
From Fairfax High. Mm-hmm.
Right. Mm-hmm. And what about the other schools you attended in Fairfax?
Fairfax Elementary.
Right. Next to the museum?
Mm-hmm.
So who were your parents?
John and Mabel Sisson. Okay.
And what did they do?
They had the automobile business on Main Street, across from Town Hall.
Which is
they
now?
Opened in 1928, and they sold to Jim McKay.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So was that ever a Jim McKay dealership at that location?
When they sold out, Jim McKay, he stayed in the old building until they built the new one.
All right, we're going to switch gears here. We'll begin with where you were born.
I was born in Fairfax off of Route 123 in a farmhouse. All three of us children were born at home.
And exactly where was the farmhouse located?
It was next to Cobbdale. Daddy owned all that property from Cobbdale all the way down to almost the corner of 50 and over. I guess up close to where the 29 Diner is. And there was a tavern there that he built. It was called Gray's Tavern. And there's a street in there called Orchard Street. My father's name was William Hobart Beistel. And he used to sell apples and cider from that orchard. And he sold that, and they built a subdivision in there, our private homes. We've seen a lot of changes around here. A lot of buildings. I mean, it was more open land. I mean, mostly farms around here, you know. I mean, that's what my father did. He was a farmer. And I've seen a lot of changes.
lot of changes.
How about the trolley? What are your memories of the trolley?
Oh, yeah, the trolley used to run right back of our place. And what always amazed me when it would get over in Fairfax, it stopped at right there at the old courthouse. And the trolley operator, he'd get up from the front of the trolley and go up to the back of the trolley, and then off he'd go again.
Without turning the trolley
around. Yeah, it could go either way, yeah. I remember Camp Washington, it was, wasn't much up there. The black lantern is sitting right in that fork where the 50 and 29 come down.
But Camp Washington wasn't as we know it. You just remember the restaurant. There wasn't like the big grocery store.
Oh, no. It was so much open land around here, just mm-hmm. like from the crossroads of 123 and 50 all the way down to the circle. It was only two motels on the right, as I recall. One was named Holly Hill, because mm-hmm. it was up on a hill and it had holly trees around it. But there was nothing from there right on down to the circle, which was a true circle. You couldn't go through it like you do now.
Right. I would like to thank both Gladys and Betty for sharing their memories with me today. It's very meaningful to be able to record these memories and hold them. When these changes take place, it erases what was before, and they've allowed us to keep some of this in our archives to be forever remembered, and we thank them very much.
Well, I'm here today with Ellen Wigren, who is a resident of the City of Fairfax for over 50 years. And she's going to share today some of her memories of Fairfax as it's grown over the years and her information about her background.
I was born in a hospital, which in 1927 was most unusual, particularly for a farmer and his wife. I was born in Roanoke, Virginia. My family lived in Botetourt County. We raised oats, wheat, barley. Of course, there were lots of cows that had to be milked twice a day. When I entered first grade, that was the largest class that had ever entered Tripeville Elementary School. There were 60 some of us. They didn't have desks enough, and they didn't know what to do with us. So they asked the parents to furnish chairs for the children to sit on, and they furnished tables. And I still have my chair.
Tell us a little bit about when you came to Northern Virginia.
I took teacher training in college. In those days, it was called Madison College. And of course, today it's known as James Madison University. I re-met a fella named Lee Wigren. And about a year later, we were married. And we came to the town of Fairfax. And as we rounded Rust Curve, he announced, "We are moving to Fairfax, the town of Fairfax." And shortly thereafter, we moved to Little River Hills.
What was the town of Fairfax like when you moved here?
A sleepy little town. There was a dime store. Maybe a year or so later, there was a children's shop. Later on, there was a dress shop and a men's shop. And of course, the hardware store. Gotta have the hardware store.
And that was right here along Main Street?
They were right here along Main Street, from Camp Washington down past Pickett. The schools, of course, were suddenly getting overcrowded, so new schools were built. As time went on, there were 4th of July celebrations, bigger than just about 25 or 30 people getting together and waving flags. Then came fireworks and parades and lots of interesting get-togethers. I became a volunteer at Bell Willard, which had the children that had physical problems. And some of the high school students, including one who's on city council now, Ellie Schmidt, was one of the girls who, from the high school, who helped us. In fact, in 1976, we paraded in the big parade for that year. Later on, as my husband's work at the agency changed, he was able to express his interest in politics, and he ran for city council and was elected. And here is a picture of him campaigning. Unfortunately, I don't know who the man is.
Do you know what year that was?
Yeah, 73. Mm-hmm. And then as medical problems arose, he had to not run again for council. But he enjoyed very, very much working with the citizens of Fairfax.
What were some of the projects that he worked on while he was on city council?
Well, the one that he enjoyed the most and still going on was the Fall Festival. His idea was that it be for arts and crafts, to have demonstrations and people selling their products. Some of the things that he got involved in was with the Boy Scouts. He worked with the Scouts on some of their merit badges. We also were involved with the history group at George Mason. The George Mason University, of course, started out as a small college and grew. And it was fun to get involved in a lot of their activities as well. We enjoyed getting the museum going.
Tell us about some of the work you do at the museum. You're a volunteer there.
I have volunteered there. I have done work with groups that have come in for special projects, and I still volunteer at the desk answering questions.
And that's in the old Fairfax Elementary School.
That certainly is. Yeah. It was the first brick school building in the what was then the town of Fairfax.
There are other historic buildings that you have supported over the years through your volunteer work. We're here in the Radcliffe Allison House right now.
And here in the Radcliffe Allison House, of course, that was one of the first.
There are other buildings such as Grandma's Cottage.
Not only Grandma's Cottage, but also Blenheim, and of course the new visitor center there.
What made you so interested in history?
I couldn't help it. My grandmother was a historian, I guess you would say, and we got doses of history of the family and the area.
Thank you for sharing your memories of Fairfax.
Glad I can do it.
I'd like to begin by asking you some basic questions, like when were you born?
I was born in a little hamlet called Rosedale, New Jersey. Well, the precise date is April the 2nd, 1917.
And how did you come to work for the, was it Department of the Army?
Yes.
What's the story behind that?
The Ordnance Corps. I walked in there and I had a pair of white coveralls. And I knocked on a door and the instructor came over. And he thought I was a maintenance man that had gone over to fix something. And I said, no, I'm going into this class. And from that start, 26 years later, I was heading up the entire program nationally. And then the big job opened up at the Presidio of San Francisco, the 6th Army area. Changed my life entirely. I was married there at the Presidio. And my three kids were born there. And from the Presidio, I was transferred into the Pentagon. And from the, and then I, that's where I stayed for the next 18 years until I retired.
Mm-hmm. Well, when you came to Washington and you were assigned to the Pentagon, obviously you were having to find housing and move your family and all of that. How long was it between that time and you came to the city of Fairfax, or what was then the town of Fairfax?
Oh, a real estate agent drove me through Fairfax, and I drove down through town, and they had parking meters down there. And except for the parking meters, if they removed those, they could film Stagecoach here. And I liked it, and I liked the house, and I liked the neighborhood, and I decided to buy it on the spot.
It didn't take you long to get involved in the life of the community.
Well, my first job, my neighbor had a son getting ready for Little League. He came up and told me that there was a job open, and he thinks that I would, he knew I was interested in baseball, if I would take it. And I said, what is it? And he said, Deputy Director of Minor Leagues. When I was Vice President and President, we built the picket road fields. We started with two hills and a swamp.
Now, did most of the work was volunteer?
Yes. We got the trades of all the parents. And they used to lend us all this heavy equipment on weekends, and they ran it. Bulldozers, whatever we needed, for nothing. We built those fields for nothing.
Very remarkable. Well, after your involvement with Little League and Babe Ruth, what was your route to eventually becoming a city council member?
I had a call from a man that I knew well, and I had served on a special commission with him. And he called me about 9 o'clock at night, and he told me, he said, Pat, I'm going to ask you to do something. I said, what? He said, run for the city council. I said, you're crazy. He said, no, and he talked to me for about a half hour or so. So then I called him back and I said, all right, I'll run under one condition. You never ever ask me for a special favor, and you never ever try to tell me how to vote. He said, you got a deal. And he kept his promise and I kept mine.
How long did you serve on council?
Five terms, 10 years, and then I was recalled.
What accomplishments during your tenure that you're most proud of, or one of your legacies?
When you speak of legacy, the president of the Little League program, he came to see me. They had a little place on Sager Avenue that the Matthew people owned, Mr. Matthew, and he let Babe Ruth have it. And then Mr. Matthew turned that over to his children, and immediately they wanted to charge rent for it, about 800-900 bucks a month. And they said, we just can't afford that. What can the city do for us? I said, what if I tomahawk the council into leasing you an acre of land to build on? And my preference would be Providence Park. And he said, well, that sounds interesting. And we got talking, and they got talking. He said, well, it's going to take a lot of money. I said, well, I remember Little League. I said, on registration day, we got a lot of kids in this program. You interview their parents, see what their skills are. Heck, they got an architect that drew up the plans for nothing. They had a guy by the name of Russert. He supervised that work. And he was there every Saturday and Sunday. Well, the place is there, and it will be there.
Well, that's a great legacy project, that FPYC clubhouse.
Well, I got about three others.
Okay, what are the rest?
the veterans amphitheater. When I proposed it, I got the cold shoulder. So I waited a while, put my file in my cabinet. And when they start redeploying, I pull it out again. And the timing was good, and so I got a unanimous decision.
What's another? You said there were a couple of other ones?
The museum building, that was already up for sale with the old Fairfax Elementary School. And that was among the first, and it was in process when I got on the council. So I went there and I said, dear God, I said, this, I smell history here. And after we stopped the sale of it, they rearranged the package deal. And I think that parking lot could be shared with both, but we gave them elevated parking. That was a good trade-off.
Well, it's a beautiful building, and it's restored now, and it's really remarkable for a city to have such a first-class quality historic building.
I volunteered there for 15 years, or 14 or 15 years, as a docent.
Mm-hmm. It's been a remarkable journey of public service, not only to the city of Fairfax, but to the United States and our country. And we appreciate your service, and thank you for taking the time to talk with us.
Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity to do it.